Let's enter into our time of worship. Spend some time singing songs of praise to the Lord. Man, He is so worthy of that. Amen. We sing "The Battle Belongs."
When all I see is the battle, You see my victory. The mountain, You see a mountain, and as I walk through the shadows, Your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with You. So when I cry, my hands are knee high. Oh man, the battle belongs to You. And every fear I lay at Your feet. Oh, I sing through the night. Oh man, the battle belongs to You. And if You are for me, who can be against me?
Come together and singing songs of praise. It really is a highlight of my week as we come together as a church family, as a body, to sing these songs. And they're really just the truths of the Lord and the foundation of what we believe. And so it's what brings us together, and let's continue to lift our voices to Him. Amen.
There is a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. A hallelujah louder than the unbelief. There is a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. Fight for me.
take this morning. It's a time of our service where we're going to take communion together. My friend Clint's going to come up and share with you this morning.
So one of the things I noticed this morning is that with a mask on, your phone won't recognize you. Oh, it's crazy. A couple of weeks ago, Mike shared a story of the fishes and the loaves. And I was thinking about that, and I wanted to go back to that because, you know, sometimes you got to push the rewind button a little bit and think about it. So I'll start by sharing the passage out of Matthew 14 a little bit. You'll recall, after hearing of John the Baptist's death, Jesus went in the woods. He went across the river and withdrew to a solitary place, and all the people followed him. And as evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." Jesus replied, "They don't need to go away. You give them something to eat. We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. They answered, and he said, "Bring them here to me." And of course, you know the rest of the story. What I want to do is talk a little bit about the backstory on this, just a little bit. This passage from Matthew, he doesn't record who shared that or where the fish came from. But John does. And John talks about the fact that a small boy had 5 loaves of barley loaves and 2 fish, who had offered this to the disciples when they'd been scrounging around saying, "What do we got?" And this little boy had in some way offered this to the disciples, thinking, "Well, I guess it's mine to give." And that got me thinking a lot about how in this season and in our lives, we're often called to do the same. God wants us to give those little things. It was a sacrifice. But look at the impact that that boy made. Now, I am quick to say that I believe if the little boy hadn't come forward with the loaves and fishes, God would have found a way. But God used this boy by giving him a nudge, and he followed. Now, sometimes God's quiet voice asks us to do something small to have consequences of faith in someone's life or in the church. Sometimes walking with God requires small acts of faith. We may not see the outcome. We may see the outcome as the little boy did, something miraculous, something magnificent, or we may never. The point is, being with God means being obedient when he asks you to do something, big or small. But particularly this morning, I want to think about the small. As an example, it occurred to me that, you know, think about your relationships that are important to you over the last year or years, and some of those have fallen away. Christmas is a great time to think about connecting with people who maybe need a word of encouragement, just to say hi, just to connect briefly and say, "You know, I was thinking about you. How are you doing?" And I want to encourage you as we go into prayer and prepare for communion that you think about that. Take a moment to thank God for this small boy's example of faith and for the relationship he desires with you. Be willing to share your lunch when he asks. Seek his love and his abiding spirit in this Christmas season. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, meet us here in this moment. We celebrate the life you give us and the love you share as Emmanuel, God with us. Help us to share that love in big ways and small this season. Amen.
to sing a song to close out this time of worship together. A song that we've done a couple of times is titled Scars, and it really just talks about the wounds and the pain that we go through in life and how that defines us and how that draws us close to the Lord. So we'll sing that this morning.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain, wouldn't trade it for anything. Brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story of you. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart, and I know they'll always tell.
Church family, today is the second Sunday of Advent, and we're talking about replacing anxiety with peace. And this is something that we all struggle with. So today I'll share a personal experience in my life of giving up anxiety for peace. 5 years ago, I was happily working for a nonprofit in Alaska in a job that I loved, and one day I felt God asking me to trust him by giving up that job for something else that he had for me. Oof, I did not like that, and that was not something that I wanted to do, and so I stepped into, like, stepping into an unknown job market and leaving a job that I love with no reason to leave it, but I prayed, and I honestly procrastinated a little bit, and ultimately, I was convicted or reminded that God's way of doing things is always better than mine. So There was a factor that made it more difficult for me to plan out my next job. They wanted a 6-month leave notice, and so I couldn't have a job really lined up very well, and so I was definitely in a place of trusting and just asking God what he wanted. But I was also running around like a chicken with my head cut off and going to interviews and, you know, sending in applications and stuff like that. And I felt God just saying, be with me. Just be with me. Don't be in a hurry. Don't worry. I have a plan for you. And it was hard to trust and just be with him when I felt like there was a fine line between being unproductive and resting. But when I stopped trying to problem solve and seeking the next thing on my own, he prompted me to apply for the job that he had for me that whole time. And I was also able to serve on the board of the company I had just left. And I couldn't have orchestrated that. That was all him. And so he reminds me over time to look back at the times in my life that he has done those things for me. He has orchestrated the plan that he had for me when I let go of my own thoughts about what that should look like. So I need to be reminded to live life with him, and that replaces my anxiety with peace. And when I see people who I'm driving down the street, they're in a hard situation or something like that, my prayer is always, Lord, just be with them. Just be with them, whatever they're going through. So every week, we want to express our desire to embrace what Christ has done for us in a collective way through a responsive reading as we light the Advent candle for the week. I'll say the first line that's up on the screen, and then we can all say the second line together. As we light this candle, we welcome the light of Christ by replacing anxiety with peace.
Well, we're going to sing a Christmas song. We can't sit while we do that, so I invite you to stand as we sing, What Child Is This?
What child is this who led to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch our King. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing.
morning. My name is Cassia Hobbs, and I'm on staff here. And I completely agree with Randy that we need to stand up to sing Christmas songs. And to me, the privilege of getting to sway while you sing Christmas songs is a big deal, because I grew up going to Zion Lutheran School, preschool through eighth grade, and we did a Christmas choir concert every year. And we were not allowed to move during the concert. They were very strict about that. And so I enjoy the freedom of getting to sway while I sing. Anyway. Welcome this morning. We're so glad that you're here and could join us. If this is one of your first times here and you've never filled out one of the connection cards in the seatbacks in front of you, I encourage you to fill that out and let us know that you're here. And there's a place where you can request different information about what things we have going on at the church. So I'd encourage you to do that. And then regardless of how long you've been here, on the back side of that card, there's a place for comments and, more importantly, prayer requests. And we love hearing how we can specifically be praying for you. The staff pray for that, but also we have a prayer team that get a prayer letter once a week. And are praying for the needs of people going on in the church. And if that's something that you would enjoy getting to pray for people and you don't get that list, you can contact the office and they can either email or mail that out to you once a week, so we can all be praying together for the needs of people here at the church. So I'd encourage you to do that. And you can put those cards in the offering boxes in the back. Or if you're joining us online, you can fill out a connection card on our website, and you can also give online. So would you pray with me this morning? Father God, we thank you that we can be together today as a church family. We pray that you will deepen the bonds that connect us together and help us to grow in your love. We pray blessings over the offering today, and we thank you for the work that you do in us when we give. Whether we give of our time or finances, the sacrifice of giving does good work in our hearts, and we ask that you use these sacrifices for your glory, God. We lift up Val and Waffle Lomlilo in Uganda as they work to plan a mission trip with a team from Suburban and from Northside. And we pray that you will bless this preparation of this team, and that you'll provide for them financially, that you'll build up a new mission team leader from Northside, and that you'll bless the construction and development happening in the village in Uganda. We lift up Corvallis Evangelical Church and their pastor, Ryan Thorson, and we thank you that we're able to partner with other churches in our area to make an impact in our community. We ask you to bless Corvallis Evangelical for their heart, for their neighbors, and those in need. Please guide them and their efforts to reach people in this season, to point them to you, Jesus. God, we ask for your spirit to stir in our hearts and open our eyes to how we can be reaching out to the community this season. May everyone here at Suburban know that they can be used to bring people to you. May you give us the confidence and courage to reach out to those we're in relationship with, to share testimony of how you have been with us, God, and to love others like you love us. Please be with Pastor Mike as he shares with us today. Let us be open to the message he is sharing and do the work to apply it in our lives. We thank you for the gift of your Son being with us this Christmas and always. We love you, Jesus. Amen. So before we continue with the sermon, I have a few announcements. First of all, I'd like to let you know that we have these postcards, these giant postcards, out in the lobby. And we have thousands of these. And they were intended to be mailed, but that didn't work out. So we need your help. We need you to take these and pray how God would have you use them. You can mail them out. And these postcards are inviting people to Christmas Eve service here and to our services throughout the Christmas season. And you can take them and pass them out in your neighborhoods. Just stick them on people's doorsteps as you maybe go for your regular walks or things. Or you could, if you have a community center or something, you know, take a stack and put them out. Because we want people to know that they're invited to church. This season, so many people are seeking because they know there's something more to Christmas, but they might not know what it is. And so we want to do everything that we can to invite people to church. In fact, you might hear Pastor Mike's voice on Hope Radio Station even inviting people to church. So let me know if you hear that. And there's also a project that we're a part of that you'll see out in the lobby. It's called Rhonda's Nickels. It's a memorial effort for a friend of actually my mom's who passed away. And she wondered why people don't evangelize more. And so these are these cute little wooden nickels with a sweet message of God's love for people, and they're meant to be given out. There's some instructions kind of with the box. As you have conversations with people, is a tangible thing that you can give someone as you're talking to them about Jesus being the reason for this season. And so I'd encourage you to check things out in the lobby with these postcards or these nickels and ask God what he would have you do to be part of reaching our community this season. We also have a video now from one of our volunteers talking about some other ways that you can get involved.
My name's Dina Cooper. Serving has looked different for me over the last seasons of life, but currently I spend time down at the DHS office here in Benton County. What started as delivering welcome boxes for every child led to an opportunity for me to get to know and to love some of the folks that work in the office, and I now feel led to serve and support them. What I've learned is not to ever assume you know what people's needs are. Ask them and genuinely listen. Another powerful truth I've encountered is that sometimes the greater the need is, the more fruitful the small gestures are. I have the privilege of leading a hospitality team that serves goodies and baked goods on a monthly basis to the staff at DHS. We do this as a form of encouragement and support to them. In addition to that, I get to meet a variety of needs or serve in a variety of ways as they arise throughout the month. My deepest desire is that every time I get to say yes, that yes will point someone to Jesus. Last week, I was presented with an incredible opportunity, and that's what I'd like to share with you. Christmas visits are being planned for the kids in care and their biological parents. As we are meeting to discuss the needs of the children's party, my heart just felt led by the Holy Spirit not to miss this opportunity to express love to the parents. This is the first chance that I've recognized to have indirect access to the parents of kids in care. So what that looks like is care baskets. We're going to provide blankets, socks, and hygiene items that each of these parents will leave a visit with. What we would like from you is to join us in prayer. On December 12th, we'll have those baskets here to be prayed over before they're distributed into the community. If you'd like to contribute financially, that can be done to the community fund that Suburban has set up. You can find that under the Givings tab at our website. In addition to that, please pray for this time that these kids are going to spend with their parents and that this season will truly be marked with the hope and the joy and the peace that it's meant to.
Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us, only sky.
We got some singing along going on in here. Hey, way to go. So before we jump into the sermon, I want to go ahead and release the kids. So kids, kindergarten through fifth grade, if you don't want to be part of the musical sing-along that is to come, you can head out in the back right now, and Miss Kiki is there to take you to your class. And also just a quick update for everyone. Over the last couple of weeks, we have asked our members to vote on our upcoming refinance and a principal prepayment. And I just wanted to let everybody know that both of those issues passed with an overwhelming majority. So we appreciate you being involved and weighing in on that. And we will update you on the details of the refinance when it closes, hopefully, you know, middle to the end of this month. So the music that you heard as we were walking up here is the opening to John Lennon's song, Imagine. And obviously, at least some people know that song, but a lot of you might be familiar with that because it's a very well-known song. In fact, Rolling Stone, not too long ago, put out a list of like the 500 greatest rock songs of all time. And Imagine came in at number 3. So it's a popular song. And if you look at the lyrics, right, it talks about how we're invited. It opens up saying, imagine there's no heaven, right? It's easy if you try. And then it goes on, it says, imagine that there's nothing to kill or die for. There's no religion to. And then it ends up with this plea, like, imagine all the people living life in peace. Like that right there, it really is John Lennon's answer to the anxiety, to the chaos, to the disorder that we see in the world around us. He wants us to picture a world like, okay, if only things like religion and national identity and borders and the military might, if only those things were gone, well then we could finally have peace. Now, I want you to keep that idea in mind because we're going to come back to it in a minute. But this morning, we're continuing on in a sermon series that discusses some of the different ways that people relate to God. And we're framing this series up in kind of an interesting way by using prepositions, right? If you got to go back in your head to eighth grade grammar class and remember what those are, prepositions are those little words that show us what the relationship are between other words in the sentence. And really where it comes from, there's a really important preposition that Matthew, in his biography of Jesus, uses when he's describing the events around the birth of Jesus. So near the end of that, he's talking about how Jesus is going to be born. And then he takes the time to point out that all of these things are happening to be a fulfillment of this prophecy that an Old Testament prophet named Isaiah had said years and years before. So it says this. It says, "All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel." And then Matthew, knowing that a lot of his readers didn't understand Hebrew, helpfully translates what Hebrew in what Emmanuel means in Hebrew. He says, by the way, that means God with us. So with, right? That's what we're calling this series as we lead up to Christmas. We're calling it with because with is the preposition that I think Christmas is really all about. It's about how God came in Jesus and was with us. But the remarkable thing about Christmas, we tend to think about Christmas as, you know, what happened 2,000 years ago and Jesus was with us in the manger, and that's great. But one of the really amazing things about Christmas is that God wasn't just with us back then as a baby in a manger. Thanks to the work of the Holy Spirit in our life, and thanks to the fact that we live on this side of the resurrection, God still can be with us today, right? God still invites us through the power of the Holy Spirit to live connected to his power and his presence on a daily basis, right? He wants life with us. But while that's God's desire, that he lived with his people, you know, all of us, over the years, we've picked a lot of different prepositions that we might use to try and describe the relationship that we want to have with God, the lens that we want to have with him. So over the 4 weeks in this series, we're looking at four different prepositions. And we're talking about these four different ways that people tend to relate to God. And as we see, as we walk through this, each of these actually has an element of truth to it. So there's some value in it. But every single one of them also falls far short of the ideal that God wants for us, which is living life with us. And this morning, we're going to look specifically at this word over. Like, we're going to talk about, okay, what does it mean to approach life, you know, with this life over God mentality? Now, this approach, obviously, this life over God, it's obviously, we see it all the time outside the church as well. It's really common, I think, particularly for people who either have not had a lot of experience with organized religion, or maybe they have seen the ways that religion and religious people over the years have not followed God faithfully and have ended up doing damage in the world and the lives of other people. So for them, it's this idea like, okay, basically the best way to approach life is just not have God in it at all, not have religion and superstition and its influences in it. I mean, that's why I opened up with that song, right? Imagine. That's really the picture of life that John Lennon is inviting us to think about, right? Life really would be better. We could really have peace if we could just somehow imagine a world without religion in it, without God and all the trappings that go along with that. And that's an idea, I think, that is really appealing to a lot of people. The only problem with it, though, is that it doesn't really work. I mean, even a quick review of the history of the last century will show you that the brokenness of human nature really trumps that ideal time and time again. Right? Think about the 20 million people who died under Stalin, or the millions of people who died during Mao's Cultural Revolution. Or just think back to last week, Ben and Kathleen Wondering were here sharing with us, they're working in Cambodia. Think about Cambodia's recent history and the 2 million people who were killed there by the Khmer Rouge just 30 or 40 years ago. Right? The leadership of those countries was really explicitly built on a worldview, on a philosophy that says, you know, life is better without God in it. It's basically that life over God approach. But the historical record is pretty clear on how that approach fails, right? Sort of not having God in the equation is not a guarantee, like John Lennon says, that things are going to work out well and we're all going to live in peace, right? So that's how that approach, the life over God approach, shows up outside the church. And it's not surprising that you would find that view outside the church. But what I think is surprising, or can be surprising, is that view actually shows up fairly often in the church as well. And when you think about it first, you think, well, okay, why would life over God show up in the church? Because we're kind of all about God here. But when you really step back and think about it, it's not as surprising as you might think. Because if remember that this life over God approach, it is all around us in the world, right? It is all around us in the culture. And because we grow up in this world, because we live in this culture, we are shaped by our culture. We are formed by our culture. Our culture influences the way that we might naturally think and value and process things. So there are people whose faith and whose approach to God has been shaped by the very same forces that led our culture to embrace this life over God approach. So what I want to do is talk just briefly about some of these cultural forces that shape all of us. And to do that, we need to take a little trip through history and philosophy. And I realize that that may not be all of your things. In fact, I realize that Philomath, like, they had finals at the high school this last week. So it's like, just like, no more school, please, no more history lecture, nothing. So if that's where you're at, we're going to get this done in 3 minutes, okay? So if this is not your bag, just hang in there. In 180 seconds, we're going to blitz through about 250 years of philosophy, culture, and science to set the stage for what we're talking about today. If you need to get it, gut through this, just go ahead and set a timer on your phone, okay? So here we go. Okay, we'll go. So think about the world that we all live in. Our world has been shaped in so many ways by the positive scientific advancements over the last couple of centuries since the Enlightenment. You know, the Enlightenment, it kind of started, Newton's sitting there, the apple falls, he figures out that there's this force called gravity, and it sort of sets this chain of events in motion where people don't just look at the world and assume that what happens is because of, you know, there's capricious gods who make things happen. They start to realize, wow, there's predictable and there's rational laws and principles that are understandable that govern our world. So oftentimes before this worldview, kind of a more scientific worldview, people really did use superstition to try to understand and control the world around them, right? So you want things to go, you want good crops, right? Well, you got to sacrifice enough goats to make sure that the rain comes. But over the years, right, with the last two centuries, we've come to see that the world is really governed by physical laws that are rational and predictable. Right? The entire reason that Oregon State has an engineering department is because the world is governed by these laws that are predictable and that we can figure those out. And it really has impacted the way we live today. So again, before the Enlightenment, right, if one of your loved ones was sick, you might, you know, sacrifice a chicken or go see a shaman. But for us today, we don't do that. If somebody that we love is sick, we go to the hospital and they have surgery. Or we go to the pharmacy and we get antibiotics that can deal with the infection. Right? Science has helped us understand more of our world, and it's produced tools and procedures that we trust can help us. So we know that the physical world is governed by these predictable and rational laws, which is a good thing, right? It's led to lots of progress in our world. But unfortunately, that has also shaped the way that we often approach God. So studies have been done of people who attend church in the U.S. to try to figure out, like, what is the picture of God that they have? And what the studies show is that many people don't actually have a picture of God that corresponds with the biblical view of God. Right? The view that we've been talking about in this series, that God is with us. He wants a relationship with us. Instead, what they found is that when you really dig down to what people actually believe about God, many people in the church hold a view of God that is really closer to what scholars would call deism. So if you don't remember what deism is from your philosophy classes a long time ago, the easiest way to think about it is that the way that deism approaches the universe, they say, okay, there is a God, and he created the universe. But once he created and set it in motion, like, he kind of left the building, right? It's running on its own. The forces that he put in place, those are governing it. He's not really involved in our world. He's especially not involved in our day-to-day lives today. And the image that often gets used to describe the picture of God that you see in deism is that God is a watchmaker. Okay, I mean, think about watches, right? Not these watches, but like the old watches with the cogs and the springs and all those gears and things. You ever see pictures of what's inside it? It's incredibly complicated the way they all work together. And they say, okay, that's what God is like. That's our world. It's incredibly complicated the way it all works together. So God put all the cogs and springs in place. He got it all set up, and then he wound that watch up, and now it's off and running. Our world is off and running, but then once he had done that, the watchmaker got up and left the room, right? It's kind of Elvis has left the building. He's not around anymore. In the room, the universe, it's just running on its own according to these laws. So if that's your view of God, that he's not involved in things anymore, and that's your view of the universe, think about how that impacts the way that you live out your faith or the way you try to face the anxiety and the fear that mark life in our world. Right. Last week, we looked at this life under God approach, and the way that the life under God approach deals with anxiety and fear in our world is by basically saying, okay, if we can just follow enough of the right rules, and if we can just do enough of the right rituals, then God owes us. He's like contractually obligated to keep us safe from all this stuff in our world. Well, the life over God approach looks at that and thinks, well, that's how a primitive man thought. We don't do that anymore. No, we understand that there are principles and laws that govern this world in the way that people with a life over God approach anxiety with, is they say, okay, if we can just figure out the systems and the principles, well, then we know what we need to do to fix things. We don't actually need God. We can kind of cut him out of the equation because we know the right strings to pull, right? We know the right levers to push in order to get the results that we want. And, okay, that's, by the way, the 180, that's the end of our history lesson. You guys, students, you made it through it. Way to go. Only a couple of you were sleeping, so perfect. And here's the thing. While some of the specifics of what we're talking about today, they have some of their origin in the scientific advancements of the last couple of hundred years. This has been a tendency of the human heart for a long time. In fact, there are several places in Scripture, you know, written thousands of years ago, where you see this approach to God show up in the Bible, and it's interesting because in each one of these places, God kind of steps in and says, no, right? It's all about the relationship. He reminds people of the importance of relationship when they want to just rely on the principles. So let me share an example of that with you. It comes from Numbers chapter 20. So if you want to follow along, you can turn there in the Bible, or there's some red Bibles in the seats in front of you. You can turn them to the page number on the screen if you want to track along. But let me kind of tell you where we are in the story of the Bible at this point. So at this point, in the book of Numbers, God has rescued the people of Israel out of slavery in Egypt. And they're on the way. He's sort of leading them to the land that he's going to give them, we're going to live. But to get there, they go through a desert. Well, it's a desert, so one of the things that there's not a lot of in the desert is water. So a little while before this in the story, there's a moment when the people are running out of water, and Moses, their leader, knows, like, well, this is a problem, right? They're going to die. So Moses goes to God and says, God, I don't know if you've noticed, but people are thirsty. And God says, okay, here's what you need to do. You've got your walking staff. Go take it, hit that rock with it, and water is going to come out, and everybody will have water to drink. So sure enough, Moses goes, he hits the rock, water comes out, everybody drinks. Well, fast forward a little while, and now we're in Numbers chapter 20. So the people have been going along, and the people have been pretty cranky, honestly. Like, one of the words that keeps being used to describe the people of Israel is that they're grumbling, right? They're complaining, like, oh, it's hard out here in the desert. Why can't we just go back to Egypt? We had food there. Oh, it was so great. Moses is like, you were slaves there. But anyway, the people, they're just looking at the present, and they're grumbling. But they get to the point where they're out of water again. So we're going to start reading in verse 7 because here they're out of water again, but this time God gives a little bit different instructions. So it says, the Lord said to Moses, right? Moses goes to God. He said, God, we're out of water again. And he says, all right, take the staff and you and your brother Aaron gather the assembly together. Speak to that rock before their eyes and it will pour out its water. You'll bring water out of the rock for the community so that they and their livestock can drink. Okay, this time he's supposed to just speak to the rock. So Moses took the staff from the Lord's presence, just as he commanded him. He and Aaron gathered the assembly together in front of the rock, and Moses said to them, listen, you rebels, must we bring you water out of this rock? Then Moses raised his arm and struck the rock twice with his staff. Water gushed out, and the community and their livestock drank. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you didn't trust me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land I give them. Now, this is a strange story, and it's one that has really kind of puzzled people for a long time, mainly because it's out of character for Moses. One of the things that we've seen in Moses' life so far is that Moses repeatedly doesn't know what to do, so he goes to God, and he's like, hey, God, what do you need me to do in this situation? God says, I want you to do X, and Moses goes, and he does X. He does what he tells him to do. But for some reason, he doesn't do that here, right? God, he goes to says, God, what do you want me to do? He says, I want you to speak to the rock. And then somehow, between this moment where he hears speak to the rock, and when he actually gets back to where the people are, Moses decides to not do what God says to do. And instead, he ends up striking the rock. He disobeys God, and there's some pretty significant consequences for that. God says, hey, because of this, you're not going to accompany the people into the promised land. So I think that this is a puzzle that it's worth thinking about, right? There's a question we need to ask, which is, why didn't Moses just do what God told him to do? And over the years, scholars and people that have looked at this, they've come up with a number of different thoughts on this, but here's one to consider. Now again, remember, picture the situation that Moses is in, right? Moses is leading this massive group of people that as the days go by, they get crankier and crankier and crankier. They're getting angry, they're grumbling, and at this point, they're also getting really desperate because if they don't have water, they're going to die. So as a leader, Moses is facing real pressure to deliver. And I wonder if this is one of those moments where that pressure got to him. And instead of listening to what God said to do, right, he felt like he needed a guaranteed solution. He's like, man, I know God said speak to the rock, but I mean, that'd be a new thing to try. Like, I don't know if I want to do that. I know what worked before, right? So maybe I should just go back and do what worked before, right? So he went with that. And I think, okay, this is an example of the anxiety or the fear, the instability, the insecurity of this situation pushes him to leave this direct word that he got from God in the conversation and to put his trust in a system that he knew worked. Now, there are probably other lessons that we can draw from this passage, but I think there's something to this. One way to read this is to see that Moses is choosing to operate his life not based on what he's getting from his relationship with God, but based on some principles that he thinks are coming from God. He's exchanging the dynamic, day-to-day, interactive relationship that God wants to have where he is with him for a set of rules and procedures that he can operate by in order to get the result that he wants. It's almost like Moses is putting his trust in the watch and not in the watchmaker. And I think that kind of thinking is what can show up at the heart of a Christian expression of life over God. Right? We exchange the relationship that God wants to have for us for other things, even for really good things. But the things that we exchange that relationship for are things that are cleaner and neater and easier to control than a relationship with the living God, because relationships are messy, right? Here's another example of it. This one comes from the life of Jesus. So there's this fascinating passage that I want to invite you to look at in John chapter 5. So in this passage, Jesus is critiquing some of the religious leaders of the day. But before you look at what he says to them, you need to understand these guys' background. So these were people who, for their profession, right, their entire lives, from 12 years old on, they had been studying the Old Testament, what we know as the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures. Many of these people had the entire Old Testament memorized, okay, and they spent all their waking hours debating and talking about it. You can go online and you can look up sort of Jewish scripture and commentary in the Mishnah. I mean, it's just amazing the amount of material that they generated by having all these conversations about every detail in the text as they're trying to extract every command and every principle and every little bit of instruction from it. And all of that is a good thing. But Jesus says it's not the best thing. Right? Jesus calls them on the carpet essentially because he's like, you spend all of this time studying Scripture, but you are missing the point that Scripture points to me. Like, I'm standing here right in front of you, and you still don't understand who I am. So he says this. He says, you search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it's they that bear witness about me, yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life. Right? The critique that Jesus offers of these religious leaders is that they are fundamentally missing the point of Scripture. He says, look, guys, if you think that the main point of Scripture is to be like an owner's manual for life, right, that its primary purpose for existing is to reveal divine laws and principles for living, then you are missing the point. The Bible is not a rule book. The Bible is first and foremost God's revelation of himself to us. Right? Every word of the Bible can help us know God better and to help us truly live the life with God he created us to live. Because it's through the Bible that we understand and discover who God is, and we discover how he wants to be involved in our lives. It shows us him so that we can come to him and have life. Now, please do not hear what I'm saying as like, oh, Mike's downgrading the Bible, or he doesn't value the Bible, or he's like, we don't need that. I mean, the Bible is incredibly important in our lives, and it absolutely has amazing truths and principles and laws that are in it. That's not what I'm trying to do. In fact, the Bible itself talks about the incredible value of the Bible in our lives, right? It says that every bit of it is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training in righteousness. The Bible contains amazing principles and truth that we should apply to our lives. So in one sense, the life over God approach has some truth to it. It's getting this part of it right. The Bible does contain God's wisdom that can help us navigate life in this complicated world. But I really do think if the primary way that we think about the Bible, if we see it, okay, it's just a collection of divine principles for life, we can really easily slide into this trap where we start seeing God as a distant watchmaker who isn't involved in our life, who doesn't want a relationship with us. Right? We can end up like those religious leaders that Jesus criticized, because instead of searching the scriptures so that we can have an encounter with the living God, we're just looking for rules so we know what levers to push to get what we want so we can chart our own course in life. And when we do that, we run the risk of exchanging a relationship with God for a relationship with the Bible. Right, let me say that again. Right? We can easily fall into the trap where we exchange a relationship with the living God for a relationship with the Bible. And after all, if you think that God's a watchmaker, why do you need to have a conversation with a watchmaker if you've already left you the owner's manual? I mean, how many of us ever actually call the customer assistance hotline in the owner's manual, right? We don't, because we got everything we need in the owner's manual. But the point, of course, is that the biblical view of God is that he is not a watchmaker. He's not distant. God loves us, and he wants to be in an active relationship with us. But again, think about the culture that we grow up in. Think about those forces that are around us that shape us. Because those forces are there, we got to be on guard. We have to be careful that this life over God approach doesn't take our love and appreciation for the incredible gift that is the Bible and somehow elevate the Bible over our need for a dynamic and trusting relationship with the God that the Bible introduces us to. It's kind of putting the cart before the horse if we do that. And this is what's really ironic about it, right? The irony of this life over God approach is that ultimately it leads to life without God. It leads to life without God being involved in our lives, because we don't need that watchmaker anyway. We got the book, right? It leads to life without his presence in our day-to-day lives. It leads to life without the power of the Holy Spirit working in us, helping us grow and change and mature. Think about what it does for us as a church. Right? It would lead to life together without the Holy Spirit working in our church, so that we're a place where absolutely everything that happens can be explained by the natural gifts and talents that the people in this church already have. Right? This leads to life without God in the midst of a world that is really scary and anxious and uncertain at times. And this is why I think it's important for us to talk about this in the church, because I think people in the church can fall into this life over God approach in a number of ways, right? We can fall into it because we're just shaped by the culture around us and we don't even realize we're drifting into this. But I think there's sort of another layer. There's a real danger for people who have been following Jesus faithfully for a long time to drift into this without knowing it. Not because of what the culture does around us, but because we get so comfortable in our relationship with God and the church and what we do, we can just kind of fall into autopilot. My wife Martha and I were talking about this just the last couple of weeks as I was putting this together. Just so you know, all the good stuff in the sermons come from her. But like you guys didn't know that one already. No, but the thing is, like she was talking about how much she needs to hear this message personally and how much I need to hear this message personally. Now, our lives are not perfect, clearly. But for the last few decades, we really have done our best to try and follow Jesus. And because of that, we've taken a lot of the principles and wisdom that we find in the Bible, and we've tried to live that out as consistently as we can. So while our lives aren't perfect, we feel like we've tried to build our marriage and our relationships and our finances on our goals in what we see in the Bible. And because of that, we've seen God's good work in our lives. We believe our lives are better doing all that than they would have been otherwise. But for us, at least, that's where the danger comes, that we can unintentionally fall into this life over God approach. Because, you know, we learned and implemented those principles in the context of a dynamic and loving relationship with God. But they've been in place for a long time, so it's pretty easy to just fall into autopilot and to forget that God still wants to speak to us, still wants to lead us, still wants to be with us. And, you know, when things are humming along, it's easy to get distracted by other things. Just forget that God is with us. It's easy to even fall into the trap and think, well, you know, I mean, I know God's got a lot on his plate. Like, there are other people he needs to talk to. There are other situations he needs to deal with. And because we're just kind of going, we do run the risk of going days at a time without remembering that God wants to be with us, right? We live without God because we just forget that he's still there, that he's still wanting to lead, that he still wants to be with us at times. And that is a tragedy, because to navigate this life well, we have to know that God is with us, and we have to experience that God is with us. We absolutely need to know what the Bible says, and we need to allow his power to help us live out the principles that we see there. But more than anything else, we need to access the presence and power of God that is with us. We never outgrow that. That is the only way to truly experience peace in the midst of the anxiety that we have in this world. And in one sense, that really is what Christmas is all about. You know, on Christmas, among other things, God came to replace anxiety with peace. Because there is a peace that can only be experienced when God is truly with us. In fact, if you go back to Luke's biography of Jesus, he tells the Christmas story, and his is the version with all the details about, you know, Mary riding on the donkey, and there's no room at the inn, and there's this great moment, right, when the shepherds are out there, and all the angels show up, and first they're like, well, don't be scared. He says, we've got good news. But have you ever stopped as you were reading that story and thought, well, what is the good news exactly? What's the context of that and the content of that good news? Well, the good news is that people don't have to be afraid anymore, because now there can be peace on earth. And there can be peace on earth because for people who know that God is with them. And that message, right, the true peace only comes with the active presence of God in our lives. That's a ball that the rest of the New Testament just picks up and runs with. Right, John's gospel shows us that on the night when Jesus is about to die, he's talking with his disciples, his closest friends, and they are in a rough spot because Jesus has just told them, hey, guess what, guys? In a couple of hours, I'm going to get executed. So they're worried. They're anxious about the future. But he promises them that he will always be with them through the gift of the Holy Spirit, right? And this is what he says. His presence would bring them peace. He says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. So do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. Now, one of the things that has always struck me as I've read those chapters in John is just the very relational invitation there. It's Jesus talking with his friends. He's inviting them to come and to be with him in this intimate and caring way. He wants his followers not to be afraid, not to be anxious, but to have peace. And he's going to give that to them by being present with them through the power of the Holy Spirit. In fact, a little bit later, the early Christian leader Paul is writing to some Christians in the Greek city of Philippi, and he gives them some really specific things that they can do when they are feeling anxiety in their lives, and they're all couched in terms of the relationship that they have with the risen Christ. He says this, he says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which goes beyond anything that we can understand, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now again, think about how do we access that peace? It's through relational terms. It's through prayer. It's through conversation with God. And as we do that, Paul says that we will experience in ways we can't fully understand the actual presence of Jesus being with us, guarding our hearts and our minds. As we close this morning, I'm going to pray in just a minute. We're going to have a song to sing as we close it. But before we do that, I just want to let you guys know about something that's going on up here. Honestly, I hadn't thought about sharing this, but then when Tyann was talking and kind of sharing about her experience, about how God helped her deal with the anxiety, some of you guys know this because a few of you are here on Tuesday, but we're in the middle right now of a three-week seminar that we're offering on Tuesday nights about how to help people who are dealing with anxiety. It's specifically targeted to helping kids and teenagers deal with anxiety, but the principles that are coming out in there, they're really helpful for everybody. And I don't know how many of you guys know a kid or a teenager who's dealing with anxiety, but my guess is if you know any kids or any teenagers, you know one that's dealing with anxiety because it is an incredibly anxious time that we are living in. So this series is actually being led. There's a professor from Oregon State who's coming in and doing it, and the content is so helpful. And I know some of you may be sitting there and you're thinking like, well, I mean, you know, I'm a grandparent. I don't even have kids at home anymore. Yeah, I don't care. You should still come, right? I think about some of the most significant investments in my life in difficult seasons that I went through, and some of those came from my grandparents, right? So all of us, we're either dealing with anxiety on our own or we know people who are. So this is a seminar that can really be helpful to take this concept that we're talking about today and actually put it into practice in how we live and how we love other people. So that's going to be this Tuesday night and next Tuesday night at 6:30. There's an in-person version up here in B4, but you can also access it via Zoom if that works better for you. So even if you miss the first week, you can come and jump in now. It will be worth your time, I promise you. If you need that Zoom link, you can contact the office to get that, or you can just show up on Tuesday night. So anyway, advertisement over. But as we close this morning, what I want us to do, the musicians are going to come out, and we're going to enter into a time of prayer. And my hope and my prayer is that the words of this prayer and then the words of the song that follow can just create an environment for each of us to have a conversation with God about what we need to do with what we've heard, about what it looks like to access the fact that he is with us and that he really does want to make a difference in our day-to-day lives and the experience that we have with anxiety. He wants us to know his peace. So with that in mind, would you pray with me? God, we are so grateful. We are so grateful that Christmas is all about how you are with us, and not just with us 2,000 years ago, but you are with us today. And God, specifically this morning, as we talk some about the peace that only comes from you, I just pray that you would help each of us know what it looks like to access your peace, what it looks like to truly live life with you so that we would experience your presence and your peace and your power in our lives. And God, for some of us, that may be just as simple as taking time to pray and experience that. For others, Lord, the way that you are calling us to access your peace may come through different ways. It might come from seeing a counselor. It might come from getting other voices in that can help us change the way we think and push back against maybe some of the messages that we've gotten all our lives from the culture around us. But God, the good news that the angels talked about is that anxiety doesn't have to win, that there can be peace on earth for people who know you. So God, as we pray and as we sing, would you help us know what it looks like for us to access that peace in our lives today? And beyond that, Lord, we recognize that we live in an anxious world. You know, I think because of 24-hour news channels and the internet, you know, it's not like the world is any more chaotic today than it was 1,000 years ago, but now we just know about it all, right? Because we get the headlines and the updates. And God, that can push us in two directions. It can push us, it can be a good thing because it can push us to pray and to invite your peace and power into different situations that impact people all around the world. Or it can just leave us overwhelmed, not even knowing where to start. But God, those of us who know you, who have access to your power in our lives, we start with you. And would you open up our eyes this week to people in our world who maybe don't know that message, who maybe don't know your peace. Like Clint was sharing this morning, Lord, this is a season where maybe you just want to bring to mind people who are in relationships with us that need to understand what your peace looks like for them. So would you give us the wisdom to know how to be instruments of your peace, who carry that to others so that we can see your good work come in the lives of people around us. God, because it seems like there is no way forward in this life when we look at the anxiety in us or the anxiety around us. But we trust that you can make a way even when we can't see it. We ask these things in your name, Lord. Amen.
We're going to close with this song, Waymaker. We invite you to stand as we sing this together.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you.
We sing that again, you are here.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are a waymaker.
stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working.
It's been good to be with you this morning. Just as you go, remember, church is not over, because church is not what we do together. Church is who we are together. So I would encourage you before you leave to take some time, connect with the people who are here. If you want some snacks while you do that, there's some Christmas candy out there, as Cass said. If you're worried about the calories, I've got a wonderful opportunity for you. We need to stack up all the chairs on this side of the room in steps of six. So if you do a couple of chairs, you probably earn yourself some Christmas candy. That's all I'm saying. So this side of the room only, stacks of six, and we'll push them up against the wall. If you can help with that, that'd be great. If not, we look forward to seeing you next Sunday.